Let's go. What's up? It's your boy Big Ben. We're tuning into another episode. This is our very first episode for the Let's Go to Church Gospel Show with Big Ben. Guys, this season 8. It's been 8 years, guys. This is 8 years I've been doing this show. It's kind of mind-blowing, Starting out at 17 years old in the industry, it was just like, wow. I don't know, it's shocking because at 17 I didn't think I was gonna be in the industry like I am now, with the marketing promotions company, my radio station, 2-time Stellar Considerate station, a lot of hats and a lot of things I have done over the years. And I didn't think this show would last that long, but we're here. We got another special guest for y'all tonight, Evangelist Lillian J. Lloyd. Let me tell y'all, this woman is a powerhouse. A powerhouse singer. I might affectionately know her as the lead vocalist for Ricky Dillon and New G. Guys, she, one more chance. My soul said yes. I got the victory. So many other hits. She just and then she got her own music that's out, her solo career. Guys, let me tell y'all, her cover is fire. Her the way she's dressed, honestly, the way she's dressing, I'm like, come on, ain't nobody else can do that. Nobody else can do that. So, Miss Lillian, how you doing?
I am wonderful. How are you, darling?
I'm doing so good. I'm just so it's such an honor to have you on the show,
It's an
and
honor to be here.
I'm ready to chat with you. I'm ready to chat. So let's talk about
Absolutely.
the little Miss Lillian, growing up in the church. So I know you're a PK. You're a
Yep.
PK. So talk about that growing up, and then. When did you know that singing was that? Okay, this is what I want to do.
I was a hot mess. When most kids were when most kids were playing with jump ropes and hula hoops and skates, I was somewhere listening to the Walter Hawkins family, and I was somewhere listening to Edwin Hawkins and Andre Crouch and all that stuff. And then I was listening to Problem and Funkadelic, and I was listening to Mother's Finest and all those bands, Earth, Wind and Fire. I wanted to be a singer. And I knew
Yes,
that
ma'am.
very early on, 5, 6 years old, I was asking my mom to play. I was requesting certain records. I wanted to hear Tremaine Hawkins. I wanted to hear, there was a group called Passage. This is way before your time. But you probably heard the song Stomp. Then we're gonna take it to the top. We're gonna stomp all night in the neighborhood. I'm sure you've heard that somewhere.
I heard
If
it
you've heard on
somewhere.
the radio, the song came out long. This group by Yeah, it's a group called the Brothers Johnson. Well, anyway, the Brothers Johnson did a gospel album on CCM album years ago, and the name of the group was Passage. And
Right.
when they did that album, I always wanted to hear because it just had this Louis Johnson, who was my favorite bass player of all time. He was playing these crazy bass licks on that record, and I just would listen to that all the time. Well, the young lady that was singing in their group, and I can't remember if she's the wife of one of the brothers or if she's the sister of them. But at any rate, she had this really pretty curly hair. And I thought she was just so beautiful. And so I'd ask my mom, Mom, play the curly haired lady. Play the curly haired lady. I want to hear the curly haired lady. And so she would put that record on for me, and I would just be in my own little world. And I just knew then that I was going to do this as a career. I knew just, you just know. From a kid, what you're going to do for the rest of your life. I knew I wanted to sing. I knew I was going to be on stage. And so I spent a lot of time in the mirror lip syncing to albums and listening to records and listening to choir music and directing the choir and James Cleveland and all that, directing the choir. I'm on the road with James Cleveland, in my mind. I'm on the road with Andre Crouch. And I would have all my teddy bears lined up
Wow.
across the bed and have my mom's perfume bottles. Those were my awards. I was winning an award, winning a Grammy. And I just want to thank all of you, my team and my people, my crew, the band. They worked so hard. I was giving these speeches.
That's a really big imagination at that age. That's a big
Oh yeah,
imagination.
I was a mess. I would read the backs of the album covers. And so I'm on there thinking Calvin Bridges, and I'm thinking all these people I'd never met before in my life. I want to thank Darius Brooks, and I want to thank this one and that one. Lady, you do not know these people.
Yeah.
I want to skip Casey for doing my sound. Dude, you saw this man's name on the back of a CD cover. You have no, I mean, the back of an album cover. This is records back then. And I would just memorize these people's names. But the crazy thing is, well, that's about speaking things into existence. I was literally speaking stuff into existence because most of the people that I imitated and mimicked, I ended up working with these people when I got to be an adult. I ended up meeting them. I ended up working with them. And before I could introduce myself, they already knew who I was. And they were telling me, oh, God, I'm such a fan. You are fantastic. You're amazing. I'm like, you think I'm amazing? Are you crazy? You're amazing. I'm all right. You're amazing.
Wow.
You're good, you. You're good, you. You know, so that was, that's the beauty of my reality. Just
honestly,
seeing things, hearing things, and then being able to do those things when you grow up.
Yes, ma'am. So I was thinking, I was kind of like that, kind of. I had a big imagination, if that makes sense. But I think those are the most creative people, honestly. People that had, like, growing up, had the most creative. They have stuff always going on in their mind, like creative stuff going on. Okay, I got this idea. Let me write it down. I got this idea. Let me write that down. I'm like that because I got to write stuff down. Because my mind sometimes be going 20 miles an hour. I got this idea. Let me put it down. And then God was like, okay, you don't put that out yet. You just say that. But I want to put it out now. No. Just save it. So, yeah. Yes, ma'am. So, later on, you got older. You got older. So, how did you get into the gospel industry? I know I watched a previous interview with DeLeon.
Yep.
DeLeon's interview. I think his name.
That's my brother, DeLeon Carr. Yeah. Yes.
And you started with B. Chase Williams.
Yes. After my youth choir days, I started. That was my first professional recording choir, B. Chase Williams, and he's the one that I have to give credit to for training me and teaching me and grooming me, polishing me, molding me, rebuking, reproving, embarrassing me, hurt my feelings. He was the one that had that job of letting me know that does not go with that. Stop. That sounds stupid. Stop doing that little thing. That's not cute. You're flat, you know, because when you come into a situation where you're excited, when you're zealous, as old folks say, zealous, when you're zealous, you come in think that you know everything. And somebody has to tell you, no, you don't. Do it this way. But he didn't just critique me. He corrected me. He steered me. He led me and guided me and taught me so much of what I know. So when, by the time Dr. Dillard came along and found me, I was already ready. I was already ready for his stage. I didn't have to come in there and figure out how to do anything musically. I knew how to develop that. I knew how to sing that sound, that famous Ricky Dillard New G sound. I already had that coming in the gate. I already knew how to perform. I already knew how to keep an audience captivated and whatnot. The one thing that did happen while I was in New G is my range actually increased.
Wow.
Singing high like that really increased my range because New G altos is a different kind of altos.
Yes. Y'all high. Y'all up in the raptures.
All the way up. And so everybody says, Lillian, you're a soprano. I'm like, no, I'm a New G alto. There is a difference. So that will make you think. I'm an alto that thinks soprano thoughts. That's what I tell people. I just think soprano thoughts. When you hit them high notes, I was just thinking soprano thoughts. But I'm an alto. Yeah. And being at the funeral today, really, oh, you'll probably want to edit that out. The way I just moved, I was trying to get my, I had my heating pad behind me.
No, you good. I edit now.
Okay. So let me start that over. So being at the funeral today reminded me you are definitely an alto because them songs is high.
Yeah.
Those songs are very high. and people don't realize how high those songs are. We were singing Keep Living. That was from the
Yes.
The Keep Living album. That was the second recording that I did with New G back in 2010. And that as long as you breathe, that's the freaking alto part.
Wow.
We I'm are telling you. High.
Y'all are, but honestly, I think all choirs now are singing high because I sing with a choir. BJ McCoy and Worship Experience out of Chicago.
Oh, yeah.
I sing with them.
Y'all
so
play too much. Mm-hmm.
Our tenors, I'm considering myself a second tenor, if that makes sense. But
yeah,
he wants me to sing first tenor, and he wants me to be in the raptures. And I'll be like, I can't breathe.
I can't breathe. Yeah, he writes it. He's and BJ's an excellent. He's an excellent writer.
Yes,
he writes some great songs. And I said I wanted to record something of his because he sent me a bunch of stuff, and I just got to really sit and listen through that because I have to record something of his because he has some really really great songs. He writes some really great songs.
Yeah, we
he's a
gotta
good
get you
guy.
on. Oh yes, I've been with them for actually about a year now. So, and I just wanted to say we got something in common. We both sang in choirs, but
yep.
So I know, and I'm just like, okay. Sometimes during rehearsal, it'd be challenging sometimes. Oh no, Ben, you're in the alto note. No, Ben, you're flat. You're in the alto note. Come down. And I'm like, well, you told me to stay up. No, come down. Come down a little bit. You're in the alto area. I'm like,
yeah.
Okay. And sometimes, if we don't have enough altos, he'd be trying to like, well, I need you to sing alto. Well, I really don't want to. He said, well, I need you. So they use that. So, I do. I obey, and I just go do it. That makes sense. So the choir scene, you love choir music. I sung chorus. Classical music. I did show choir in high school. I did Hairspray, sung in Hairspray. We did a Hairspray
musical. Come on.
So music's all been in my family too. Grandfather was a quartet singer, and with my aunt, my great uncles and them, they were singing in the quartet group. Then my mom and my aunts and them came up a group, and they were singing for almost 20 years. So singing and music has always been in my family for years. So sadly, I'm the only one out of my siblings that got that singing ability. But yeah, I just want to tell you a little bit more about me to talk about the situation. But yes, so one more chance now. Let me tell you, you don't shock everybody when you just start laying on the floor. First of all, how did you do that? Because I was like, why should you lay down like that? I had to always sit up, okay, then sit up, because don't slouch or sit up. That laying down singing, I said, and she's still holding her note, and she's not breathing heavy? I said, what? And I said, who's this lady? Who
Trust
is
me, I was
this
breathing
lady?
heavy. I learned how to manage it, because I was a big girl down there trying to catch my breath. But see, in that moment, the anointing has taken over. So he's breathing through me. He's moving through me. He's doing all those things. And sometimes I look at some of those old videos and I just cry because I'm like, God, that was only you that was moving my body that fast. And I mean, going down those aisles that fast and going up and down those stairs. And I told Dr. Dillard, I said, you are stronger than most people know.
Yeah.
Because all these years of me falling down and him catching me, when I was at my heaviest, I was almost 300 pounds. And he was catching me like that in the moment. And, you know, I'm jumping off the stage and him grabbing me and, you know, picking me up off the stage, that kind of stuff. I've seen, watch these videos. I'm like, he just picked me up off the stage. Like,
right.
And he's steady going. You're just in the adrenaline. You don't wait. You don't feel the weight of that when the adrenaline is gone, when you're in the moment. But I'm like, oh my God. So today he was talking about, ooh, my shoulder hurts and my side. Y'all don't understand. Dr. Dilla's getting old. And so I said, that's probably my fault. I didn't wore your back out.
Honestly, I think you look beautiful all through the years. Honestly, when you say you was 300 pounds, you didn't look 300 pounds. You just,
yeah.
Like you were just a curvy, plus size woman. That was it to me.
I was a whopper, honey. I was a whopper. But
God never heard nobody say.
Mm-hmm. That was my mom used to say that when somebody was heavy, she said, "Oh, she is a whopper, honey. She's a whopper."
Oh Lord,
My
I
mom
had
was
never heard.
bad, honey. She was a trip. So,
Yes,
ooh,
ma'am.
she is a whopper.
So, singing One More Chance, was it? Did you think it was going to be as big as it is now? Like, it's huge.
I thought it would be big. Didn't know it was going to be quite as big as it became. Did not know that. Did not know that. And that it would bless people's lives the way that it has. A young lady came to me at the funeral. One of the older members came to me. She was in the choir before, before my term. And she said, "You just don't know how much you bless people." And she said, "Don't ever stop singing, keep going. Don't ever stop, because you are blessing people all over the world. You don't even know." And she just said, when she was in her lowest place and she would listen to, the songs that I've done, how it just kept her encouraged. And so many people that have come to me, people that were on drugs. There was a young lady at Cosmo this past Sunday that sang One More Chance with their church choir. She
Wow.
said, "I used to be on crack."
Wow.
See, I say, "I should have been. I could have been." I've never smoked crack.
Right.
Never have. But based on where I was raised and the neighborhood I grew up in, the people that were around, even though I lived in a saved household, everybody in my hood wasn't saved. And
True.
so it could have been the other way. But thanks be unto God that He spared me from that. I always said, God spared me. He could have allowed those things to happen to me. I could have been that person. And when she said, "I used to be on crack," it just brought tears to my eyes. I said, because people will listen to, "Oh, she can't hit the notes that Lillian Lloyd is hitting, or she can't do this, or she doesn't do that." But I'm going to tell you what she can do that Lillian Lloyd can't do. She can give her testimony about actually having experienced being high on crack
Yes.
and being delivered. That's something Lillian can't do. I can't give that testimony, but she gave it. And I was really, really blessed by her testimony singing that song. She wasn't trying to be like me. She wasn't trying to do nothing extra. She just sang what she sang it from here, from her own heart, from her own testimony, her own experience. And it just blessed my life. And so it's like God is just breathing new life into those old songs. We recorded One More Chance 16 years ago. We
Wow.
recorded I Got the Victory 7 years ago, but it's
Yes.
like God is breathing new life back into those songs. And even some of the songs that did not get as much attention, like Stay With God and some of those tunes, people are starting to go back and revisit those songs and say, "Hey, this is a hot little track." But sometimes it takes the hype to die down, because One More Chance was such a huge hit, and I've Got the Victory just, oh my God, it came right in the heat of the social media era. So TikTok and Facebook and Instagram, we didn't have all of that when I first joined New G. All we had was YouTube and Gospel Chops. We didn't have all these, we didn't have social media really. It wasn't really popular. We had MySpace, I think that was all we had when I first joined.
Right.
And that was before your time. You probably don't remember MySpace either. But but that was our only social media outlet. And but man, I'm telling you, what social media has done for us and done against us, but what it's done for us has been a blessing for people to be able to see your ministry and say, "Hey, what about, coming to do an interview on my show? Wink, wink. What about, coming to my church and ministering to my congregation? What about, because I sing and preach. What about coming to
Yeah.
preach for our conference? Come and speak to our women. Come and speak to our kids. Come speak to our young girls and our women's group." Those things. And so it's been a tremendous blessing. I'm just telling you, it has opened so many doors. So I'm just grateful for B. Chase Williams. I'm grateful for Dr. Ricky Dillard, because those stages just prepared me and are still preparing me for my life, for my future, for my career, and for the children that are coming up behind me. Is giving me what to give them. Is teaching me what
Right.
to teach them.
Yes, ma'am. Let me tell
Yeah.
you. One More Chance, and then you got My Soul Says Yes on Keep Living album. I still remember when it was on a Wild Gospel, not particularly your song, but God is Great. You know, God is Great was on that album. Man, ooh, I was like 12 at that time. Wow, gosh, ooh, Jesus, oh my
I'm about to end this
gosh.
interview. I'm going to end this interview. I'm going to end this. I'm going to end this interview abruptly.
No, I'm just saying, like, at time went by so fast. I'm just like, okay, I was alive, and I can actually, when I have my kids, I can honestly say I was alive when that came out. I've seen the process of
You're
everything.
making it worse, you know.
Yeah. So now my soul says yes, man. That song, I said, for some reason, what I noticed when you have your curly puffy hair on, it's something different. You shaking. You be shaking now. I was
Somebody called
like,
it, they call my curly hair my Holy Ghost hair.
yes, that's Holy Ghost right there. Holy Ghost. I said, when she got that on, I said, oh yeah, she about to go in. Ain't nobody gonna stop her. So better move out the way, because when the spirit hits, she gone. So you know, so my soul says yes. Okay, album 10. Oh my gosh. That album, I asked my parents to buy that for me for Christmas. I got the CD for Christmas. I got the videos on it, but let me tell you about this.
The
My
fact that you had to
mom,
ask your parents to buy you the 10 album, that's
yes.
crazy. That is crazy.
My mom, when she goes like in spiritual warfare or something like that, she praying in tongues and stuff. I got the victory. She turns it on. She goes in. She going through room to room.
Are
She
you
goes through room.
serious?
Yes, ma'am. Like, that's her spiritual warfare. She goes
Oh,
in.
wow. I gotta listen. I gotta meet her.
Oh, you do. You gotta meet her, because she'll go in. She don't care where you at. She go in after. She be going to Walmart and everything. So, that's her spiritual warfare going song. And so that song, you hear it all the time. I'm like, I got the victory. And then when you said Monday, no, when you say December, January, February, March, April, I say, now she over here. And then I said, I don't know where she at. I don't know where is she at, but come on.
You know what? Do you know where I got that from? And this is another reason why they call me the Ad Lib Queen. I gather bits and pieces of things from anywhere. I can be watching television, watching a cartoon, watching National Geographic. I can be
Right.
some just surfing on the net and see something, and it just sticks. And it's always been like that. So I just got these massive piles of what I think is useless information that will come back to me at the most ridiculous times. That little part, January, February, March, and April, now I'm in a hurry. That was a line from a children's record when I was in first grade.
Wow.
1981. It was a Sesame Street record that my first grade teacher used to play. And it was teaching the months of the year.
Right.
And it was supposed to be like a rap almost. This was when hip hop first really started to surface. And the guy was teaching us the months of the year. And so he said, January, February, March, and April, and I'm in a hurry. Dun, da, 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 da. Then he goes on and on and on and on and on. And then
Wow.
September, October, November, December. Now that I've named them all, see how many I can recall. On and on, on and on, on, on.
Wow.
That's all I remember of it. But just that little part, I would say that because I would love, I always wanted her to play that record, play that record. And she would come over there and just play something stupid. I'm like, I don't want to hear that one. Play the one with the song on there I like. Play that one, you know. And so that little rap would stick in my head all the time because I just liked the way it was moving. You know, I just liked the little vibe. It had a little funky little vibe to it.
Yes.
And so I was everywhere that I go, I got it. Everywhere that I go, I got it. And it was God that did it. because the music did that. Ba-da-da-da. We didn't rehearse that. It just happened right at it happened right at the right time.
It did.
It just happened. It just fit. Oh, Mike Taylor.
No, you good.
Lord have mercy, Jesus.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
No, you good.
We just for those that don't know, we just left our MD's homegoing service today. And so that's just one of the memories.
Yes.
Of just those moments, him and Quad and Derek and my cousin Bird. And I think what's his name played on that record too? Jabari played on that record as well. And so Brent Easton on drums. But just we made some great memories. Yes. Just to create, it's not just, you don't just show up and sing songs, but you have to learn the songs and you have to be taught those songs. And you have to know it's not that part, it's it's not it's So you have to learn all the little intricacies. And then in rehearsal, when we get a chance to, all right, add the lead vocals, let's hear what you got on this. Lead vocals comes up in rehearsal and we sing it for you for the first time, our interpretation of that song. And when I came and sang, I Got the Victory. In rehearsal, and I posted clips all week of what happened in rehearsal when I actually performed it for the first time, baby. We had knocked down, drag out church.
Literally.
In the rehearsal. So we already knew that it was going to be explosive in the performance. And that night, it was bigger than anything we could have imagined. The whole room was up. It was in shambles.
Yes.
And I will never forget when we did the single release, we sang it. We was marching out of the church. Everywhere that I go, I got it. Everywhere that I go. And so we marched out. Like I sang it all the way till we got to the door. Dr. Dillard looked, leaned down and kissed me. He said, "We got us another one, baby. We got us another one." I said, "You think so?" He said, "Yes, absolutely. You hear these people? This song's a hit. Are you crazy?" And yeah. So it was just, we have just had some wonderful moments and created some things that will last for many years to come. See, let me tell you something. Let me learn you something, as old folks used to say. Let me learn you something. You can have a hot song that's hot today. Is it going to be hot a week from now? Is it going to be hot 2 weeks from now? Is it going to be hot a year from now? Is it going to be hot 5 years from now? Is it going to be hot 10 years from now? What about 12 years from now? Is it still going to be hot? Are people still going to be requesting for you to come and sing it? Yep. Your song might have been the hit when the record first dropped. Who's booking you to come sing it, though?
That point.
Huh?
Come on.
So you have to, and that's not a cut or a shade or anything, but you have to have something. You have to be able to create something called longevity. You've got to put something in that song that will give that song life long after you've recorded it, long after that record has gone off the charts, long after that season has passed, new albums come out. People still wanted to hear One More Chance.
Yeah.
When we dropped Keep Living, people didn't want to hear My Soul Says Yes because they still wanted One More Chance.
Yeah.
My Soul Says Yes was a wonderful song.
It was.
But nobody wanted to hear that. They wanted to hear One More Chance. They were expecting that. Even when we got up to record it that night, the people in the audience were talking about, "Ooh, One More Chance." I'm like, "Sweetheart, this is recording. Clearly, y'all don't think we're about to sing One More Chance tonight." This is the next recording. It's been 3 years. Are you all crazy? So when I got up there and sang My Soul Says Yes, and I didn't lay on the stage, baby, they was a little disappointed in me. It was like, how about this one? It's, and I'm listening, like, did I vocally do a bad job? Wasn't it I vocally did a bad job that people wanted that show that they saw the first time? The next time we come back with Stay With God, the audience responded very well because they weren't expecting to hear me sing a moderate tempo song.
Yes.
They weren't expecting that. They didn't really know how to receive it at first. But once we got into it, they were like, I'm liking this song, Miss Lily, and that's cute. We still want one more chance, though.
You can't leave without singing one more chance. So anytime so, anybody books you, does any that this you have to sing one more chance all the time? Is that the number one song they always ask you to sing? Wow.
Got to do it. Either that or victory. They will be fine as long as I do one or the other. I can sing all the other songs I've written. I can sing everything else, but as long as you and I got to let them know, I want y'all to calm down. I'm gonna open with a new song, but I promise you, I'm gonna sing what you want to hear. I want y'all to calm down. I'm gonna sing your song. I promise I'm gonna sing your song. I'm not gonna leave here without singing your song.
That's amazing.
But I got to give y'all some new stuff too, because there was a time that One More Chance was a new song. Y'all had to hear it before you fell in love with it. So you got to hear these other new songs too, so you can fall in love with them. Because you might find that you might like some of this other stuff as much, or if not better, than some of the other tunes you've been used to hearing. Got to give stuff a chance. At least press play and listen to the song.
I'm telling you, song after song, and you have been on multiple other people's, featured on other people's records as well.
I just went live on IG and we had this conversation about how many albums have I been on. And I'm just like, I lost count. You got Jason Wright, Danelle Damon, Pastor David Wright, New York Fellowship, Steve Dalton out of Carolina, Sherrod Allen from James Hall Worship and Praise. I just did a song with Travis Malloy and Pastor Corey Mickey on Manifestation Bump. We just did... So many albums. I recorded with Rayshawn Walker back in the day on this project he did in Denver. He brought me in for that. Eloquent Weaver, I did one song on his album. I think the name of that album was Hallelujah, if I'm not mistaken. And then I just recorded a song with him a couple years ago. We haven't released it yet, but it's a remake of an old Thomas Whitfield song. That's How the Lord Works. And then I just recorded with Faris G out of Detroit, and his group is called Jeremiah. We just did a song that God's Got a Blessing with Your Name on it. The name of the song is called Breakthrough. I gave it a long verse. The name of the song is Breakthrough. And so it's just a bunch of songs that I've been featured on. Lamont McCoy got a song on his album. The name is leaving me right now. I think it's Highest Praise on that album. And that's another moderate tempo. Got a nice little swing to it. Just so many songs that I can't keep up. Stop By, Well Done with Danelle Damon. We recorded a song, He's Able, and that was written by Melvin Crispell, the late Melvin Crispell, God rest his soul. And we recorded that, but we didn't release it. I recorded a song with my son's father. That sounds crazy, but my spiritual son, his father did an album, and I did a song called Prayer and Faith. Mm-hmm. And that didn't get released, but I recorded it. I've recorded so many songs that never came out, songs that are gonna come out. I've got a couple of recording sessions coming up this year. That just more features. And so, you know, you do what you're good at. You keep doing what you're good at. Well, you don't want to get overly saturated. Hush. And you're not going to be overly, and you ain't oversaturating nothing, because gospel music does not get the airplay. Independent artists don't get the airplay. So some of these songs will never see the light of day for some people. You know, you'll have it'll be a hit in your region. People in Carolina may know it, but people in California may never know it. So there is no such thing as oversaturation when it comes to, you know, from that perspective, because there's just a group of people that will never hear it. You know, I just recorded with Eddie Baltrip and his choir. I did several tunes with. I got a lot of songs out there because the more I'm talking, the more I'm thinking. I've done two albums with John Bernard.
Okay.
We did a song called Lifeline, and then we did a song called Mama's Song. His mother wrote this song, and she did not live to record it, so I had to go in the studio and record it for Mama's Song. And just so many songs. There's so many songs. A lot of them are fast. Some of them are moderate tempo. I did Teal Durden, Tory Durden, out of Alabama. This song called Prayer's the Key. And I love that song. Absolutely love that song. But that's a slow song.
Yeah.
But it's
a lot of
whole
music.
Bunch of them out there. That's a lot of them out there. I said I'm going to put that. I just recorded with Pastor David Wright again. We did Magnify Him from an old 1988, an album that his dad, Reverend Timothy Wright, and Myrna Summers recorded back in the 80s, Magnify Him. And he and I did that song together as a tribute to his dad. So I'm very excited, but I can't wait for that record to come out. Yeah, so I got a lot of songs out there that in on top of One More Chance and Stay With God and My Soul Says Yes and I've Got the Victory and God's Gonna Do It, you know.
Come on.
Got a lot of songs. And then the songs I've written that, you know, I've put little snippets of my original songs out, and people that have heard them, they really like it. When we go and do those songs, we record those songs, we go and perform them live. When I do my solo concerts, people really like the songs. It's just, you got to give it a chance and have the opportunity to have the opportunity to do it. Because people are used to just bring me in to sing one song. They just want me to come and kill it at the end, basically. They want me to come in and just do the up-tempo song because all it takes is one. She's going to come tear it up and nobody's going to want to come sing after her. So that's what they usually put me up to do, you know, because for so many years I was the closer for New G. My song always closed the show. And so when people saw that and they saw the chemistry that Dr. Doolittle and I have, they wanted that. They want that, you know, that's what I want. I want you to do that same thing at my concert. I want that same thing at our conference, you know, so. They want me to do the same thing, but they don't have the same ingredients that we have. You ain't got this screaming choir. You ain't got this crazy band. You ain't got Dr. Dilla waving his arms or Dr. Larry Jones waving his arms. And then you don't have the sound system. You don't have any of the other components that make that situation happen. So there's that. But we make it do what it do. We make it do what it do. All in all, I enjoy what I do, and I'm going to do it till I die. I'm gonna do this for the rest of my life.
Come on, she made a decision, guys. She made a decision to do this for the rest of her life. Amen.
I will be doing this for the rest of my life. I made a vow to the Lord, and I won't take it back. I mean that. I made a vow to the Lord. I'm going to sing. I'm going to preach. I'm going to do what God called me to do. See, here's the thing. A lot of people helped me, but only God called me.
Catch it. If you ain't catch it, y'all need to catch it, because I catch that. Come on.
A lot of people helped me. A lot of people gave me an opportunity. But God called me.
Come on.
God anointed me. And God gifted me.
Yes.
So let's not get it twisted. And it's not just me. Anybody. When you see somebody standing up doing the work of the Lord, you see them flowing in anointing, don't give the credit to a man for that, because a man didn't give a woman a gift. A man didn't give another man a gift. God gave us these gifts. God gave us these abilities, and God gave you the ability. Whatever you have, God gave that to you to be able to give an opportunity to somebody else. So let's not ever get it twisted and think that we made somebody, we created them. No, you didn't create this. This is the Lord's doing.
Come on. Guys, I need a booker to speak it now. She can preach you under now. You have to run around and speaking in tongues and everything.
Yeah, I'm working on because I really enjoy teaching. I really enjoy teaching. I love to preach. Of course, I love to preach the gospel, but I love talking to singers. And so I'm developing a master class. I have a book that I'm writing. I've been writing for the past few years called The Theory of Ad Libitum. But a lot of the parts that in the book are kind of painful to deal with now because some of the characters have passed on. And one of which was one of my mentors and my best friend, Volley Craig. He was one of the baddest bass players you ever wanted to hear. And just a phenomenal musician overall. He was classically trained as a pianist. He played the organ, he played drums, and he played bass. He played lower brass in high school. And so he was just a phenomenally talented musician, but his primary instrument was bass. He played for Aretha Franklin. He played for Thomas Whitfield. He's played for the Clark Sisters. He's played for the Winans. He's played for you name it. He's played for Puff Daddy. Before he was Diddy, he was Puff Daddy. He was Puffy. He played for DMX and Lil' Kim and all those on those tours. And he's just traveled all across the country and across the world playing for all these different groups. And so that was my mentor. And so writing our story now that he's gone, I can write a little bit and then I have to stop a little bit.
Yeah.
Because I can't. I cannot deal with that.
Right.
And he was taken from us suddenly. See, when somebody has a sickness, it's one thing you know they're gonna go and you watch them decline, but he went to sleep one day and didn't wake up. So it was a sudden death. He had a heart condition. And so I'm assuming that he just had a heart attack in his sleep. And it just he was gone. He was gone.
Yeah. But
I
man, you know,
texted one
God's
of them. Huh?
God's time is different from our time. And so
Oh,
maybe it's
absolutely.
you can release it yet till you get that that void, or I guess a void, if that makes sense. A void. What's the void? Every void, that void that you're feeling when you're writing that certain portion of that book.
Absolutely.
So yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
So as I'm developing it, and because to me, I feel like I owe it to him, I owe it to his memory, I owe it to his legacy. That's how you keep people's legacy alive. You continue to do the thing that they taught you. What good is it for somebody to pour out their heart, pour out all these lessons on you, and then when they die, you just stop?
Right.
But what was all that for?
True.
What was all of this for if you're not going to run with it? His death to me would be in vain if I didn't continue the work, if I didn't continue to teach and speak on the things that he taught me. The time that the many hours that we sat and talked, and he just poured so deeply into me, poured into me, sharing different things and sharing bits of his journey with me. And not just Bali, but Andrew Gushue and Mike Burrell and Kevin Stancil and all these wonderful, phenomenally talented musicians that I know that have just sat and just giving me hours of their time to share their journey with me. You don't waste people's time. You know,
Right.
take that,
Well,
take those lessons and run with them. Take those lessons and learn from them. And
yeah.
even us sharing this now, don't have this conversation with me and say, hey, I talked to Lillian Lloyd. Take something from this conversation into your career, into your future. Share this information with somebody else. Don't let us just gather and ramble. And yeah, I went to Pittsburgh back in 85. We had a time out there in Pittsburgh. No, there's more, you know. But what did you learn in Pittsburgh? What happened on the way to Pittsburgh? Because that's some of the conversations that really need to be had. What happened after the show in Pittsburgh?
Right.
Yeah, so a lot of those stories. One of the musicians, Quad Salters, was talking about Mike today. And he was saying that Mike was like a father to him on the road. He, you know, taught him what to do and what not to do as a man, you know, how to carry himself. And he was just talking about what an example he was, you know, of how a man, not just a regular man, but a married man, how you're supposed to conduct yourself when you're out on the road doing ministry.
Yes.
And there was just a certain way, a certain decorum, you know, and he was just talking about how Mike kind of gave him a lot of insight on that. And then Derek Hearn talked about how he was able to be the glue that held all those guys together, and how he was able to neutralize those egos and that hype, and you know, I'm this, I'm that, I'm the okay, good. Wrap all of y'all up. Now here we are, one level playing field. We're a band, one sound. Bring all that in. He never had to raise his voice. He never had to, okay, yeah, that's good. All right, now let's do this. And you're like, oh, okay. he just had a way. He just had a way. I posted a clip from a rehearsal, from a recording session that we had. We were preparing for the 10 album. And you could hear his voice. He was in the booth, and we were he was on the board, and we were recording the line, not to us, but to your name, the glory, that part. And we had to do several takes of that. He said, all right. He said, be careful on those notes. He said, I know it's high. He said, but let's work together. All right, let's try it again. Give me three more of those. And so the way he said it, it was just, you wanted to work with Mike. You wanted to work harder. Did I hit the bad note? Let me try it again. I want to make sure that I get these notes right, because he was so kind and so warm. You just wanted to work with him. Some people get in the studio, they get excited when they get behind that board, and they're going to fuss and scream and holler the whole time and just make the whole experience annoying.
Yes.
You just dread sessions with certain engineers because they just get beside themselves. But Mike Taylor was one of the most easygoing and proficient. And some people are extra and then they suck. This mix is going to be awful by the time you're done. But when Mike went in that studio, everything was just, every line, every facet of that song was going to be as close to perfect as you could imagine, because he paid attention to every little detail. He could hear it. Go back. What are y'all altos? What's that part y'all doing right there? Okay, make sure you're careful on that last ah. Make sure you get on top of that. Let's work together. All right, let's try it again. That's how he talked to you. And you just, like I said, you just wanted to do it right. And he made it a joy. What is a very cumbersome, if you've been in the studio and done studio sessions, laying tracks is very cumbersome. And especially when it's late at night, you're tired, sleepy, you ain't ate, you know, all that stuff. But he made it a joy. All right, I'm rambling now.
I won't try
I can stay on that.
I wasn't trying to cut you off. I was just letting you talk. Sometimes you gotta let talk it out.
Absolutely. But music is an amazing journey. It's an amazing journey to take, and there's so much to it, and you gotta have a heart for it.
Yes.
You gotta have a heart for it. And if your heart is, and I tried to explain this before, and of course my words got taken out of context, but I'll say it again. If you're coming to a community choir, you come into a setting like that looking to be rich, then go somewhere else, because that's not where it's going to happen. You're not going to get rich singing in a community choir. You have to come to community choir because you have a mind to be a part of a family, to be a part of a unit, to sharpen your skills, to hone your craft, to be a family, to do life with somebody, and to do music and do life with that person. We didn't just lose a guy on the organ. We lost our brother. We lost a piece of our family. And, you know, it sucks. It really stinks, you know?
Yeah.
Because you gotta go back home after the funeral is over. You gotta go back home without that person. So my mind is on China, his wife, and on his girls and his granddaughters. He called them cupcake and gumdrop. I thought that was the cutest thing.
It is.
Yeah, but to you got to go back home without him.
Yeah.
And start life again. And you got to go on tour. You got to work on the next albums without him. When you're used to having him, when you've had him for 25 years, you got to learn how to move without him now. So that's why we have to value people. We have to cherish the people that are in our lives.
Yes.
When there's dissension between us, when there's disagreements, let's fix it. Don't let 5 and 10 years go without you correcting it.
Yeah.
Especially not if you're singing gospel. How y'all gonna sing about Jesus and y'all can't fix nothing? You got the Holy Ghost and we can't apologize?
Yeah. You're right.
We want the Holy Ghost to come over us so we can hit high notes and so we can squall and throw our hair all over the place and so we can stomp and stampede down the aisle and walk pews and win Grammy Awards. But we don't want the Holy Ghost when it tells us to treat people right. We don't want the Holy Ghost. We want no parts of the Holy Ghost when it's trying to teach us how to talk to people, what tone of voice to use when you're talking to somebody that's grown. So we don't want to do that. Respect the people that work with you. Respect the people that work for you. Respect the people that you work for. I would never sit under somebody that I don't respect.
Sure.
And if I got to talk crazy to you, I don't need to be under you. I don't respect you. If I got to yell and curse and scream at you, then I don't respect you. And if I don't respect you, I don't need to be under your ministry. That's whether it's your leader, your choir director, your pastor, whoever. I have nothing but the utmost respect. BJ, I don't even sing with BJ's no more, but I still have a great deal of respect for him. I have utmost respect for him. And when I go back to Atlanta and it's time for a reunion or if it's time for some special project, I just recorded a song with him called Deliver. And it's hot. It's hot. Can't wait for y'all to hear that one. We had church on that song. We got another number coming out. There's a bunch of numbers out there now.
I got a bunch of songs.
I got a bunch of songs. We could actually right now put a greatest hits album out and it would have at least about 20 tracks on there right now. We could do the best of Lillian Lloyd right now.
Yeah, the best. They used to do that back in the day. You know, the CDs,
yeah, we can do a best of Lillian Lloyd CD right now and it would have at least 20 tracks on there. 19 of them gonna be shout songs, but we can do a better song. 95 out of the 20 are gonna be shout songs, but it's, you know, there are people that love that. I have certain friends that have their whole Lillian Lloyd playlist, and they just, I'm like, you gonna play that in here with me? I gotta listen to me right now. I don't want to hear that. Turn it off.
But honestly, I noticed with our different artists, they don't like hearing themselves. And most of them say, "Oh, I don't even watch this. If it's on YouTube, I don't mind.
I just don't want to hear it over and over. I don't want to hear it 15 times."
Yeah. Now everybody knows that you.
Yeah, I don't mind.
Yes, ma'am. Now everybody knows you're a preacher. You're a powerhouse singer. But what are some of hobbies that you like doing outside of ministry?
I like to. Believe it or not, I like restoring old furniture. If I find a piece like on Facebook Marketplace, I like to repaint it and reupholster the chairs, you know, the cushions on the chairs and that kind of thing. And I like that. Sometimes
brass woman like Jesus. Amen. Yeah.
And I just, you know, I'm a spray paint queen, but I really want to do better about, you know, I want to get the materials and get the sanders and all that and start hand painting things and really learn. Because my father was a furniture salesman. And so I know good quality furniture. And so the pieces that I bought for my home are good quality pieces of furniture, real wood, not that little cheap particle board that you can just pick up and break in half with one hand. But just real quality wood. You get that and sand it down to the bare wood and be able to stain it and refinish it and bring it back, restore it back to its natural state or even make it better than it was before, make it like new again. I like that kind of, I love to watch that sort of thing. Now, I don't really have the time that some people have. You're going to have to cut, get a saw and cut the leg off and put a new leg. I ain't got time for all that now. I need it to pretty much be intact. Now, I'm down with sanding it and, you know, patching and caulking and, you know, putting the wood putty to, you know, kind of finish the surface, that sort of thing. I'm committed to that level. I'm not committed to getting no saw.
Yeah.
And sawing the legs off, and I'm gonna go find another leg and then blend it in and bevel it. I don't have that kind of time on my hands.
That's being creative, still, regardless of being creative.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people can do that. I'll be honest with you. I can't do that.
Yeah.
I'm not. The Lord didn't give me that gift. He didn't say Ben's not gonna be a builder.
So I do, and I do the little DIY projects. I'll just go get a glass bowl from Dollar Tree and put little rocks and pebbles on it and paint it and then put it, you know, make a centerpiece out of it and make pieces for my friends and little stuff like that. I make oils and different, you know, skincare for my friends, and I'm going to start selling that stuff eventually. Huh? No, this is more skincare. I had really severe eczema. It's cleared up for the most part, but it revisits me from time to time when I'm stressed. And so I have a little patch, one little patch like that on the front of both legs. Got one little patch about that big. Mm-hmm. And it just itches like the dickens. But this ointment that I make, it has shea butter and a bunch of different oils in it. Pure coconut oil, vitamin E oil, and just a number of different oils. And you just keep that area moisturized. And it just really restores and replenishes the skin. Of course, when it gets infected, you have to reach for the steroid ointments, the cortisone creams, and the triamcinolone, and those ointments that come from your doctor. But for just the daily maintenance, you definitely want to do those oils, especially being like when it's really cold here in Chicago. And, you know, I live in Vegas now, so it gets really hot. We're hot and dry. So you have to keep your skin moisturized.
Okay. How is it like living in Vegas? Because I can't do it. It's too much.
I love it. It's just like I, as much as I'm happy to be in Chicago and I can't wait to go to my church tomorrow, I literally was on my phone looking for a flight that would get me home tomorrow night right after church. And the tickets have gone up, so now I got to stay on the flight that I'm on because the tickets are like, it'll be another $250. Like, nah, I don't want to go on that bad.
Yeah, but too much.
Yeah, so I have when I go home, it's like I'm going on vacation. So I look forward to going home because it's like when you land, everybody's so excited to be there, and they're like, "You live here?" I'm like, "Yeah, I live here." So what are some of the spots I should go to? What are some of the things I should do? And blah blah blah. I was like, "Well, I'm not a tourist. I actually live here, so you know, I can recommend a couple spots for you, but just." Start at one end of the strip and just walk until your feet get tired and just keep going and go inside every hotel, every casino. There are live shows happening. There are beautiful restaurants and just stuff to experience. Go down to Fremont and just walk up and down the Fremont Strip. There's restaurants, there's souvenir shops, there's plenty of food and stuff. There's street performers. There's a zip line up there. We got roller coasters. We got everything. It's Vegas. Have a ball. Have a blast.
Don't get in trouble, you guys. Don't get in trouble.
Get in trouble because you can't get in trouble because I give this speech all the time. We gonna get your money. Vegas is gonna get that money, baby. We are going to get your money. As soon as you land in Las Vegas, when you step your foot out, the first thing you're going to see right here is a slot machine. We have 5,000 slot machines in our airport. No, but there are slot machines on every concourse.
In the airport?
In the airport. When you step out of the airport, out of the airplane, it looks like you just stepped into a casino.
Oh,
our slot machines everywhere. There are slot machines in baggage claim.
I'm trying to get my bag. I ain't trying to get over there to the slot machine.
We're going to get that money, baby.
Ew, wow.
We're going to get it when you come. We're going to get it when you go. But we're going to get that money.
That's crazy. I ain't never been to, so
You gotta come out there. You gotta come out there and check us out. You would love it. It's amazing.
still is supposed to be in Vegas again this year, so I
Yeah.
might be, so
Come on out. Come on out there and check us out. We'll show you a good time. It's gonna be fun. But we gonna get that money. Believe that. I don't care if it's just a 6-piece box of wings, we gonna get that money. If it's a $10 piece of cake, if it's a $5 bottle of water, we're gonna get your money.
$10 piece of cake. You know what? I ate a Debbie cake. I bring my own Debbie cakes and put it inside my carry-on.
We gonna get that money.
That is great. $10 for a piece of cake.
We gonna get that money. I love giving people that speech. One of my background singers in Detroit, he's coming down. Him and some of his friends are having a guys' weekend, and I said, "Why don't you guys come stay at the house?" He says, "It's 5 of us." I said, "I don't care if it's 10 of y'all. You'll need to come stay at the house." He's like, "What's wrong?" I said, "Come stay at the house and save your money, cause we gonna get that money." He started laughing. He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "We gonna get that money. Vegas is gonna get that money." I said, "I'm gonna go to the grocery store. I'll make a big pot of spaghetti and stuff for y'all to have, or some fettuccine or something that y'all can eat up for a couple of days. Make some salads and make y'all some snack packs. Cause I'm telling you, we gonna get that money."
Oh my gosh, man.
I'm telling
It's
you, you
like,
come to Vegas, you people come to Vegas with $1,000, $1,500, they think they're gonna come out of that Mac, and baby, we're gonna get every dime of that 1,500. You're gonna go home broke.
wow.
We're gonna get it.
That's crazy. That is
Cause
crazy.
you'll go to the slot machine and you will win $5,000. Before you leave that room, you're gonna feel like you can make it to 10. And you might make it to 10, but you're gonna leave with two. Cause we gonna get that money back. You better
Wow.
believe that, baby. Cause as soon as you walk 2 steps, "Hey, come over here, let me show you this." And they're gonna give you a coupon booklet and tell you you can get this for free, you can get that for free. If you come to this little exhibit, we're gonna go take you down the street to an exhibit. You're gonna stand here and listen to somebody give you a speech, and then we're gonna bring you back, and then we're gonna offer you free drinks. We're gonna offer you a one night stay at the hotel. We're gonna offer you a free steak dinner at Oscars. You're gonna eat that free steak dinner at Oscars, and they're gonna give you another little coupon that says, "Hey, this is a voucher. You can win so much, so many such and such as on the use this on the slots. You go and use it on the slots, and you get on the slots, and you won." You put five in, you won 100. For real? You're gonna keep playing that 100 until we get it back.
How long
You're
you
gonna
been
keep hitting.
living?
I've only been there for 3 years, but I've been coming off and on. Ricky brought me to Vegas back in 2014 or 15. I think we did a tour out there. And I just fell in love with Las Vegas. I'm like, oh my, but I've always been mesmerized by Vegas showgirls. And my mom always used to tell me when I did my makeup, she said, "Why do you have to walk around looking like a Vegas showgirl?" Unless she always used to say that, but I'm like, she didn't realize how mesmerized I was, so fascinated by Vegas showgirls. The beads and the feathers and the jewels and the big headdresses and all that stuff. I was just the boas and all that stuff. I was just so fascinated by that. So when I actually got to Vegas and saw that they actually walked the streets looking like this, they're all
Wow.
painted up and they have these big beaded feathers and all these cat suits and stuff with the bow. I was just so fast. I'm like, that's really happening. This is amazing. And so you see all these shows and all that. I was just that entertainer in me. I've always just wanted to live that life. And who knew? I guess God knew. He had to know that that was
Yep.
the direction he was going to send me in. And now I'm here. And so who knows?
And you
Now
turn into
you probably won't see me in a feather boa and a cat suit, but
a But honestly, I think you
maybe a
should do.
beaded gown, but not a cat suit.
I think you should come out with your own glasses lines. Your
Oh yeah, that's
glasses.
already in the works. My glasses, the wigs, the makeup, all of that. Already in
Y'all
the
need to
package.
stay tuned for that. Y'all need to stay tuned because she's gonna be having everything. She gonna have. gonna have hair products, makeup,
Yep.
glasses,
The
a
skincare,
book,
everything.
skincare, and then she got her own music that's out, her solo career.
Yes.
How was it? Okay, now I need to record my own solo music. How was that? The process of, because you singing background and featuring on other people's projects, but now this is your baby, and you had to go produce it. You got to get you some producers. You wrote the song, and so what was the process of that?
It's just like the difference between babysitting and actually having your own child.
Okay.
Because you don't get a day off from being a parent. You're a parent every day, you're a parent all day. So I didn't get to check out of that process. See, one thing about being with Dr. Dillard and being with B. Chase, they got to worry about how it's going to get paid for. They got to worry about how it's going to sound. They have to worry about what time everybody's supposed to be there. I don't have to worry about that. All I do is show up and sing and then go home. I don't have to think about it anymore until it's time for me to come back to the studio. I don't have to think about it, but when we're gone home, where we're in bed, they are up like this, thinking, doing math, and wondering, and having those conversations in their own heads. Is this going to be right? It was what's going to be the best thing for radio? Blah blah blah. They're thinking those thoughts, and so coming into doing this single on my own. I didn't have Ricky Dillard to fall back on. I didn't have B. Chase to fall back on. It was on me. Everything was on me. Who was gonna play? Now, a lot of that was on my producer. When I reached out to Patrick and told him what I was trying to do, he put the band together, and they were all my friends. B. Dub on bass, Mike Burrell on keys. Patrick played organ. He pulled Chris McCorkle to play guitar, but I wanted my child to play, so I got Jamiah Rogers. He's from Chicago. We call him Skinny. Deacon Denzel. So he's playing the lead guitar solo on there, and so we just made it happen. Jamie Gamble is on drums, so we're surrounded by musicians, so getting people in the studio is not a problem. We work with people all the time. You say the word, they show up. And so he got all these people to show up. We put these different layers together, and then I got Skinny on the phone and shot the track over to him, and he did the guitar solo, and we had a finished product. But that flying back and forth from Vegas to LA, flying from Oakland to LA, and in the midst of that, mourning the loss of my mother, all of this was going on, during that time, and just a bunch of stuff happening. And my little puppy, he was sick at the same time as well. We just had to put him to sleep a couple weeks ago. He had developed this tumor. And so I'm trying to care for him and travel back and forth. So he's with his caregiver for the most part. And they're taking care of him, and he's declining. And I'm trying to, like, mommy's coming back to get you. I promise mommy's coming back. And I went on tour in Germany, and his caregiver called. She was whimpering, holding his little limp body in her arms. She said, "I don't think he's gonna make it. He's not eating. He's not gonna make it." So we had to make the decision to go ahead and put him down while I was over there. So I'm on FaceTime watching him put my son to sleep. So I'm losing it. But this is all those things that happen. You don't get to check out and not do music because you had to put your dog to sleep, or because your mom died, or because you had a bad day, or because a promoter didn't pay you. You still got to show up and do your job. And so that's the part that becomes more challenging. It's more to it than just showing up and singing a song. It's more to it than having a hit song. It's more to it than just getting a bunch of people to make a record. There are so many moving parts, and those parts are always moving. Those parts are always moving. And so you got to be able to stick and move and go with the flow. So I have a greater appreciation for Dr. Dillard. I have a greater appreciation for B. Chase and any of the artists that I've worked with. I have a greater appreciation for them because they have carried these burdens and they have worn these hats for so many years. So many years. And they develop relationships with musicians that would just show up and learn music before they got paid. They would show up and just learn the songs and get the stuff done. And I thank God I have musicians in my life that, they're getting there with me too. That they'll just show up and get it done. Sometimes they take their little sweet time about getting it done. But
Yeah.
again, just now I'm starting to see those that are just there for me and just love me, and they're just willing, they're down for whatever. And when they say, "I got you, Queen, don't worry," that makes me feel good. When they say, "I got you, Ma, don't worry," because they know I'm going to take care of them. I don't believe in tests. I'm very funny about musicians. I don't believe in taking advantage of people's gifts. But
Right.
we got to help each other. And
Yeah.
sometimes I can't give you $1,000 a show. Sometimes I don't have that. I don't always have it to give you $500 a show. Sometimes I might only be able to give you 300. I'm just using random numbers. I'm not saying what I pay my musicians. I take care of them as best I can. And but when you take care of them, on the times you have to kind of say, "I need you to take one for the team," they don't mind because they know you're gonna come back around and you're gonna treat them with the level of respect that they deserve. And it's not no 5 and 10 gigs down the road that you got for free, and then you decide to give them $100 next time. No, I'll die.
Right.
I don't play that.
Yeah.
I don't play that about my band, because I can't sing without a band. I gotta have music. Gotta have my band. Gotta have my singers. You know. Yep. That's about it.
Let me tell y'all, I enjoyed this conversation.
Yes,
We had
indeed.
this. Lillian Lloyd. Let me tell you, it's a pleasure to meet you. I gotta meet you in person.
Oh,
I gotta meet
absolutely. Let's make it happen. Let's make it happen.
you. This was just a conversation, and it didn't even feel like an interview. It was just like a conversation, and I hope
Absolutely.
that you enjoy this interview. Yeah, and I need you to tell everybody where they can follow you at, where they can get stream your music at, where they can book you. Cause y'all, I'm not playing with y'all when y'all watching this thing. Yeah, I need to book her now. She'll sell out a house now. She'll sell out a house. People, see, I need to
Yep.
book her for next event, concert, workshop, a seminar, a wedding. I know she'd come sing at a wedding. She sing
Yep.
Lord Chester that one. She can sing Chester at my wedding.
And
I'll do
I
that.
don't just sing gospel either. I don't just sing gospel. When I do weddings and things like that, receptions, I'm your girl for your reception. Let me do the
Yes.
after party. And
Well,
I get my I'll put my band together, and we'll come in there and sing some little dance numbers for you.
you see a bit of grass or something like that. I don't know. Some Williams or some Diana Ross or something. She'll sing something.
Yeah, little Ike and Tina for you. We gonna pull it off for you, and
And we
put
already
on a
know
great
that
show.
you're a Prince lover. You love Prince.
Oh
You're
yeah,
a Prince
love
lover.
Prince. Absolutely love Prince.
Like
Prince,
she
probably the
got
Funkadelic. I love all of that.
Prince
Those are my
as her
favorites.
cover on her social media. I said, man, she really loves some Prince. So what's the
Yeah.
okay?
Yeah.
What is your favorite song?
That
What
is
is your
hard
favorite song
because
from
there's a
Prince?
lot. Prince has a lot. He's over 39 albums, so it's kind of a hard choice to make. One of my that's hard. That's hard.
I
Yeah.
know my mom said that he did a song called 1999 or something like that,
Yeah.
or
Or
something like
something like that. Yeah.
that.
Yeah.
Because I never heard the song, but she's like, yeah, that's an amazing song.
You
She's
never
a
heard 1999? I'm gonna whoop you.
okay. I never heard it.
19, we're actually doing a Prince tribute at my birthday concert. Skinny's actually coming. He's doing a set at my concert. I'm supposed to have Levi Knowles and out of Miami. And I'm gonna do a set. We're doing a Prince tribute that night. And 1999 is one of the songs in the tribute.
Oh, okay. All right. When is your
I can't
birthday?
believe you've never heard 1999. It's my birthday is actually June 10th. Prince's birthday is June 7th. So we're doing the party on June. My party's going to be on June 7th. So it falls on his birthday. So we're doing a tribute to him then. And we were supposed to do it at my last party, We did the Funkadelic tribute, but the Funkadelic tribute just ran so long because those songs are so musical and it's just a flow and it just ends up going from one thing into the next thing. So we did so much. Three songs lasted about 35 or 40 minutes, just singing three songs.
Come on.
So by the time we did
Hey.
all that, we had run out of our time. So we the even though the owner was like, "Oh, sing, sing," because she was able to count money at the bar. You know, she was so excited. She was, sing your head off. Enjoy yourself. Let the good times roll, buddy. You know.
I got Miss Lillian. I got a
Yeah.
question for you. Have you thought about acting?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I love acting. I did
Yeah,
gospel stage plays, but I want to get into television and film. Definitely.
you
Definitely.
should do it.
Yeah, there's a lot of controversy going around about how black people get paid. Here's what I say. If you don't want $15,000 to play Sadie Mae, give it to me. If you don't want $20,000 to play the role because you're worrying about what somebody else got in their pocketbook, bring it to me. Because 8,000 is better than no thousand.
Yeah, that's something. Yeah, you put that in yourself.
And you take that $20,000, that $50,000, that $250,000, whatever you get paid to do a role. I don't care if you do a role and they're only paying $5,000 an episode. Go make that $5,000. Put your money up. Stop trying to buy Gucci handbags and Fendi and a bunch of stupid labels. Stop.
Gucci and Gucci hand. When it took me out.
Yeah, stop buying all that stuff that you can't afford. And then you got to get on TV and cry because they're not paying you enough. We got to stop that.
Yeah.
As soon as you get your first $50,000 or $60,000, you want to go out and buy a brand new house that you can't afford to live in. And then you don't get another role for another year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. And by that time, you almost in foreclosure because you bit off more than you can chew. Get something that you can comfortably afford. If you don't, what do I have in front of me today? If this is how much I have in the bank, let me live based on 20,000 less than that. Let me put that in my savings. Let me put this away. Let me invest some money. Let me make some money work for me. Let me go open a restaurant. Let me go open a speakeasy. Let me do something. Let me get a clothing line. Let me get another stream of income so that the money that I make from doing these, or if I made $50,000, that's $50,000 I can take and put to work. Not $50,000 for me to go out and spend and run out of. That's $50,000 for me to invest back into myself. So
Yeah.
send me them roles that y'all don't want, that y'all like, I only made $50,000 for that.
She says, send me
Tell
the
me what
rose.
other job are you going to work and stay on that job for 6 weeks, the 6 weeks it took you to film that movie. Tell me where you're gonna make $50,000 doing that for 6 weeks. Nowhere. Well,
Boy.
Meryl Streep, I don't care how much Meryl Streep got in her pocketbook. I don't care how much that actress down the street got in their pocketbook. If you offer me $50,000, $20,000, $15,000, $2,500 for me to stand up here and say a few lines, I'm a Sam.
Now Booker, guys, Booker, she's gonna give her booking information.
Crazy though. It's crazy. So, because I mean, what's y'all trying to? You just gonna not do nothing? You gonna just not work? I'm gonna quit acting. Okay, what you gonna do? Go work retail? You gonna be a nurse? What you gonna be? Where are you going?
Right.
You can't sing. You gonna be a singer? You gonna be a rapper? You gonna teach school? You gonna fly planes? What you gonna do?
Right.
Nothing.
Guys, I'm telling y'all.
You can email me at LillianJLloyd@gmail.com. lillianjloyd@gmail.com and submit your booking request there, and somebody will contact you within 24 hours, definitely before 24 hours.
I'm telling you guys.
And just leave all the pertinent information, and kind of already know what you want to do. We was thinking about having, okay, after you thought about it, then hit me up. And that's just not with me. That's with any artist. Please don't call an artist. I'm like, we thinking about having a little program down at the church. Don't do that to people. Don't do that to us, because then you put us in the middle of plan. It's not our job to plan your event. You have to have your event already planned, and then reach out to the artist. Yeah, because we can't take that on as a responsibility. Now, if I'm your personal friend and you need my help, then you reach out to me to help you do something, but don't wear us out with that. People are tired. You can follow me on Instagram at I am Lillian Lloyd, LILLIANLLOYD, or just go on there and type in Lillian Lloyd in your search engine, and you can find in the search bar, and you can find me on Instagram. That's the easiest way to get me on Instagram, because Facebook, two of my Facebook pages got hacked, so I only have one, and that page is full. So Instagram is the best way to reach me.
Man, she said that Facebook's full. Yeah, I signed a request a while ago. You said it's full, so.
Yeah, I can move something around. I'll move something around and add you.
For real.
Because like a lot of those pages are, you know, obsolete now. You want to, people die, you want to delete their pages, but you can't delete them because you want to be able to go back and visit those pages and just remember them. So a lot of my followers are dead now. And So, but you know, some of these churches, sometimes you follow a church, you accept a friend request from a church because you went there 5 years ago. Unfollow these people. You don't communicate with those people anymore. Unfollow some of those accounts that are just your grandmama's sister's cousin, know you a singer, so they want to follow you on Facebook. All right, she's gone. You can delete her as a friend. And people that are not actively communicating with you, you kind of go through there periodically and purge your account. So I can kind of move somebody around. These accounts that don't have a face, they don't have a profile picture, these stalkers, yeah, you go through periodically. You find 5 or 10 of those and delete them.
Yeah.
And you can add people that really want to communicate with you.
Yes, totally. So, yeah, make sure y'all connect with her.
Absolutely.
Stuff for the kingdom of God. And she's so sweet. She's so sweet. I knew it. I said, she's sweet. I said, I don't care what nobody say. I said, that woman of God is sweet.
Anybody says different is a person that's never met me. If you hear somebody say, because I know there are several bloggers that are trying to pass off this narrative that I'm mean and difficult to work with, you will not talk to one promoter. There is not one pastor, one promoter that will tell you that I was mean or that I was difficult to work with. I am intentionally nice. I'm intentionally easy to work with, so that you will never have that testimony of me, because I don't ever want to go someplace and leave a bad taste in the people's mouths. And I haven't always been perfect. I have not always done everything the right way. But just in the last 5 years, you're not going to come out here talking about, no, I did. No, dog. Mm-mm.
You better get your life. Get your
life. Yeah, period.
But yeah, thank you so much once again for coming on here, guys. We are out. Put you